The next presentation is going to be by Dr. Anjan Bhattacharya, and the topic is going to be on child protection in the UK learning objectives for India. Dr. Anjan Bhattacharya is a renowned developmental pediatrician based at Child Development Centre, Apollo Gleneagles Hospital, Kolkata, with a vast experience of 25 years. Dr. Bhattacharya has worked at Newham University Hospital and Primary Care Trust, London, in the past. He aspires to bring the scientific professional training in the area of child protection in pediatric practice in India to highest available international standards. He is the immediate past National Secretary of Medico-Legal Group of India Academy of Pediatricians and was instrumental in spreading awareness about protection of children against sexual offences bill amongst the members. So we welcome you, Dr. Bhattacharya, please to come.
Thank you, Shubhangi, for a nice introduction. Thank you, Foundation, to put me out. And thank you, Uma and Siddharth, to put such wonderful positivity. It really gives a foundation to my talk, because there are so many things that will just simply follow from here. That is exactly what I'm going to talk about at this juncture, where there is a aramb, where there is a beginning. And it is wonderful to stand here at this juncture, where in India we are now talking child sexual abuse with fun. And really, obviously, we all know that it is not fun. The subject itself is not fun. But how do you take it forward if there is a culture of fear around it? You don't. So, you know, thank you for putting that positivity out there. Why? Because the topic that I'm going to talk about is how to simplify things for our country. I worked there for 12 years. I was there for 14 years in the UK. And that is what I have learned, that how to put it in the practice. And yesterday we have heard about the challenges. You know, somebody taking a case to a very high-end hospital, pediatrician trained from UK, USA, a family friend, still wouldn't touch, wouldn't get the goat going. So often we act like a bystander, the doctors. And you know this POXO thing? Doctors have to be a big part of the stakeholder, and we need to move it forward. So, what do we do? Because of this act, which is a wonderful visionary act, and what did I do with this secretaryship in Medico-Legal Group of Indian Academy of Pediatrics? I'm currently the vice president nationally. But what do we do with that? We have put a session in a Golden Jubilee Pedicon, which is an annual conference. 8,000 pediatricians from all around the country flocks into it. Because it started in Kolkata and Mumbai, this Indian Academy of Pediatrics, the Golden Jubilee year was celebrated in Kolkata. That is my town. And we had this entire medico-legal session of discussion, panel discussion, topic was on POXO. But even today, 2-3 years on, you will hardly find pediatrician talking about it. It's fear. And what did I learn from UK? That how can we practice of reporting these cases and taking it forward as a modular format, so wherever you are practicing, you can do it. So, we get to the stories. Uma loves stories, I love stories. Why? Because these are real life stories. So this is where I was sitting in Newham. Newham is where, you know, the Summer Olympics was held. That is where I used to live. So right at the end of a clinic day, in a community clinic. Community clinics are not very high-end clinics. It's not well supported. So right at the end of, you know, back in the UK, you have work hour directives and things. So people will not overwork, at least at that era. Now with economic pressure and all that, those boundaries are dissolving. They're all working as hard as we are here at now. I can see that. But at that time, you know, 5 o'clock, everything shuts down. So the last case totters along, a father and a daughter, oversized, overgrown, old looking, 13-year-old who looked like 18, with all those, you know, body piercing stuff around her. The complaint is recurrent abdominal pain. tummy hurts. And they have been here, there, everywhere, you know, Thailand, Bangkok, alternative therapies, India. The abdominal pain is not going away. I do a thorough examination. I can find nothing wrong. But during that consultation, so if you do not find anything wrong as a doctor, you are stuck. You end up spending more time with the patient because you're trying to figure out what is wrong, what could be wrong. So, in that interchange, I was observing how the father was, you know, very, very lovey-dovey with the daughter and saying, my love and all that, hugging and all that, all very loving, you know. So I'm just thinking, suppose that would have happened to somebody in India who has no formal training in this, what would that person do? What would I have done if I was just a recent graduate from India, going to UK, sitting with that same family? I would have done my examination. I would have recorded it as appropriately as it should be and let it go. Why would I let it go? It's ignorance. Why is there ignorance? Because there is no curriculum in our undergraduate syllabus which teaches us, not just in India, even in abroad, about all these issues. Issues that impacts us in everyday life. That 2007 document about, you know, half of our children are abused is methodologically so sound, you all know about it. It's so sound that no one can question that. And that is why it is in circulation. And that is why nobody challenges that, because we all know it is to be true. It's not just the select gathering. Whoever sees it, they must first say, oh my God, can this be true? But then they look into it, then they keep thinking that, oh, it must be true, because, you know, look at the methodology, they're so sound. And that is where data talks to us. And that is where we find the real truth, which cannot be hidden. And that is where training and learning matters. So what happened in this case? Remember, end of the day, my secretary is trying to go home. She and me, the only person in the clinic, the moment this one finishes, we all go home. And she is really desperate to go home. So I finished my consultation, I finished my examination. During the examination, the secretary had to be brought in because, you know, chaperoning. This is a lady, I'm examining a man. Regardless of that, we need witness. So she's in while I was examining. Not while I was talking, all those things. So I finish my examination. I sit down with the father and daughter and I say, I can't find anything wrong with your daughter's physical health. However, so this is the turning point, the light bulb moment of the bystander situation, you know. And when I say however, what do I tell? Now let us make it a little interactive. What should I say? You have had your workshops, you have had your learning, right? At least one whole day worth of proper CME. So tell me, as a doctor sitting in UK, what do I say?
No boundaries.
No boundaries is fine, but I mean, this is the father, you know, that kind of a father with this kind of a daughter, right? What do we tell them? The really big, sloppy secretary sitting and, you know, standing like that. So, doctor, finish up. That's the message I'm getting constantly. And if I may say, oh, you indie bum, finish up. Right? Under that pressure, what should I do as an opening dialogue to possible, you know, POXO says, if it is possible, you got a duty of care. It's a very visionary, it's too early for India probably. But unless it is there, we could do nothing, right? And then we'll probably discuss a little bit about what happens in India. That is a separate thing altogether. But, you know, you have learned it all. So, come on. Throw things at me. So, I'm sitting as a doctor. There is father and daughter. And there is this secretary looming around. what should I do as my next step? During the history taking and clinical examination, I have done my medical assessment part. I have taken a detailed history, right? The only handle that I'm getting is that father-daughter interaction. Yeah, but think of the issue of talking to this daughter, right? And secretary is sitting there. Now, I need to justify, why am I asking father to leave the room? You are very right. Really, some detailed assessment needs to go in. Correct? But over there, working directives are in place. I should be finishing off. So what should I do? That's a wonderful answer, by the way. Yeah. So if I had all the time, I mean, this was the beginning of the clinic. Yes, we could do something. This is the end of the clinic. Everybody has left. Brilliant. So I will continue with them. Absolutely. So I continue with them and I ask the daughter. So the secretary is sitting with me. The daughter is with me and the father is outside. And daughter is saying, oh, everything is lovely, hunky-dory. I don't know. I get this pain. These are very disabling, you know, makes me not go to the school, right? By the way, I don't like school very much. And there is nothing that bothers me in my private life. I'm happy and everything. So what do I do next? You can imagine the kind of scenario is happening, right? So I'm suspecting something. And obviously daughter is not coming out with anything. So there is no psychosocial handle I'm getting. So as a doctor, just imagine the legality around everything that we do, right? Over here, God knows what will happen. But over there, if I take a misstep, I'll be hounded down for the next 5 years of my life, of my professional life. Correct? So under that sort of framework, what could I do? Let it go? Because I've done my duty. Well, as a doctor, I have done my duty. As a legal thing, I have done my duty.
I would send her to a woman counselor.
Right, but how? It's the procedure that I'm talking about, you know? I'm talking about the procedure. How would I do that?
By telling her that she needs to see a counselor because...
Right. This is a 13-year-old, by the way. Looks 18 or maybe
needs
older.
Needs to see a woman counselor.
Okay. And if she asks me why...
That's your assessment that you think that's her next step.
Okay. So then if she asks me why, doctor, why do you think that should be my next step? I'm having tummy pain. Why do I need to see a counselor? I'm just teasing these things out so that, you know, you understand the difference between their practice and our practice and where we should be heading. Because during the Aram, it's best so that you won't have to reinvent the wheel again. You know? Yeah, please. I can't see anything. So, just shout out. Please.
So, I don't know how right I am. But the girl seems to be a little reluctant in opening up. So, maybe I would do that. Maybe I would say something like, everything seems to be fine. But still, there are some unreasonable pains that you've been going through. So, would you mind me suggesting to someone which can provide you a better help?
Fine. That's not a bad answer at all. Okay? That's not a bad answer at all. But you know where we can go wrong with that is that if you put it as a question to her and if she says no, gone. This is where the training matters, you see? This is exactly where the training matters because I'm sure you have been asked to say, you know, put things in that way. And this is a place where you cannot put it in that way because if you give her an option, it's gone because you are not acting on anything but your suspicion and suspicion alone. And your victim, potential victim, I didn't know that she was a victim. And I'll tell you the story. I mean, goose pimply stories, actually. So, that's a wonderful thing to say that, you know, I think you should see somebody next. Rather than saying, would you want me to? Right? So, that is one learning point. That's through the counseling. So what do we do? I mean, she says, can't be bothered. Can't be bothered. People who follow BBC series will understand. This is a sitcom thing. Yeah. I'm not bothered. Right? And they do really talk like that, don't they? So you have to get into their minds. And you also have another obligation. Somebody has accompanied her. She's a minor. You got to tell him also about something. At the moment, she's alone with me and my secretary. I can't be alone with her. Chaperoning is something we need to sort of, you know, put as a modular thing. And this is something all the stakeholders please take on. Chaperoning in a bold stamp letter. Chaperoning, chaperoning, chaperoning.
Maybe through your conversations you could speak to her and try to understand what could be the reasons of her pain rather than preferring her to your
family. No, that has happened. That has happened. I couldn't find anything organic, you know.
Yeah.
And I'm pretty sure there is non-organic cause. As a procedure, what do I do next? As a next step, you know, that is what is very important. Implementation, why does it fail? It fails because we don't understand the micro steps that are so very important, because this is where it is getting made or broken, you know. If I misstep, if I now refer her without a proper disclosure why I am doing it, I will fail in my duty. It will come back and bite me. Over there and over here.
So maybe you need to initiate or create the ground for a disclosure to take place.
Correct.
So either you start talking about, you know, I noticed about your father and who else is in your family, or you know, like the conditions, like we talk about, that you have to first, the disclosure right here becomes the goal.
True.
And how do you, through conversation, create the condition?
True.
For her to make
that
disclosure. Correct. Without the disclosure, you cannot actually
take effort. Correct.
So fortunately, over there, because you have got extra layers of support, right, that disclosure does not have to happen then and there in that scenario. What needs to happen is the procedure that that is what I would like to share. So what do I do at that time is that I take all those things with the daughter, and who is saying, it's absolutely fine, you know. He loves me, of course, he's my father, we have a very loving relationship and all that. And really, nothing much bad has happened. It's the nuances of it that struck me as odd. Another father and daughter doing similar thing, but not exactly the same thing, might not have that twang of inappropriate along with it. And it is my duty to explore that. Without doing that, I have not done my fulfill my duty as a physician. So it's totally hanging on my conscience. And what I'm trying to say is that through training, you can have that professionally, you know, you can imbibe that. And that is the whole point of this talk, really. So what I do is, I bring the father in when I had no handle to go along. I make them sit and I tell them, and their procedures empower me. POCSO Act actually empowers me in India to do the same thing. It's just the implementation, because if other stakeholders do not support me as a doctor, I'll be in total thick soup. I can't do it in India. At this stage, I can't do it in India. So what do I do is, I sit down with them in presence of my secretary. So she's a witness and she knows that she's a witness. This is a role that she has to play. It is in her job description, written down and acknowledged. So I'm very glad when Siddharth said, we will acknowledge you fully. These are very, very important things. You have to acknowledge everybody's contribution. Otherwise, it goes pear-shaped. And that is why it goes pear-shaped in many of the things we do. Right? So it's not this or that. The procedure says that we sit down with them and we tell them exactly where we are referring to and why. So I tell them that looking into the interaction between you two, it is possible that there is nothing wrong, but I will fail in my duty if I do not refer you on to the social services. And you know, when I say social services, it evokes a certain kind of emotion. Like, you know, if you tell somebody that I'm calling the police, that one word is enough to trigger a post-traumatic stress disorder, a fear reaction, you know. You just talk about it. You don't have to experience what happens with the police. You just the word is fearsome enough, right? This brings us to a point where we discuss what is going on with my phone at the moment. There is a case in India where parents have taken their daughter, 8-year-old daughter, to a pediatrician who has vaginal discharge. It's of recent onset. The discussion was that, yeah, just last 5-7 days it's happening. Daughter is also having itchiness over there. The examination has happened. There's nothing wrong. It's just a local irritation, a bit of redness. So the doctor advises very appropriately that, you know, these are the things you do. You wash it off with, you know, you have cotton underclothes and cotton clothing and all that, and you apply this cream and all that. They go away. Next day, the doctor gets a phone call from a police officer saying that, how dare you? How dare you advise them to wash off? You have advised them to wash off the evidence. I'm coming and going to arrest you. So this is the POCSO Act in implementation in India. Right now it's happening. So there is a huge barrage of people saying things. How can police officer do that? How can anybody do that? Doctor has done everything as per book. There is nothing. There is no suspicion. Parents have got a responsibility to report something, everything. And I am writing that no, there is a, you know, breach of care in the doctor's action. Although at this stage, I will not hold that doctor responsible. I'll definitely try to educate that doctor. So we have to have a period where the education has to go in. Otherwise, doctors will be, you know, paralyzed in fear. They can't function if you just go and start catching all of them. And medico-legally speaking, as the current practices go, nobody can hold this doctor wrong. Current practices of India will tell you there will be a huge of support that what the doctor did was absolutely fine, which it is. But it wasn't fine, in truth, right? There was something that has happened, and there was an opportunity that was missed. In fact, doctor's advice created the problem. It created the problem from the police. But the police doesn't know that that is not the way to approach the doctor. You need sensitization, you need to help the doctor. POCSO says very, very clearly, police's role is supportive. We got to train them, and we have to have time frame. This is why I'm having the talk. We need to put these things on pen and paper and say that this should be the time frame for this kind of awareness, and after which it will be negligent. Before that, it is another unfairness lashed out, undermining the cause and destroying it really once and for all. Just like how that wonderful series Satyameva Jayate didn't really go through, right? Too much truth, too soon. I loved it because I would like to have a big shout about it, but it wasn't, country wasn't ready. Sometimes we get it right, sometimes we get it wrong. But here, there is a very concrete proposal that we have. We work through all the stakeholders. During the road shows, we can actually agree to what should be the time frame. 3 years, 5 years, what? Because if we don't do it right, we will actually delay the process. If we do it too soon, try to be too gung-ho, we'll damage it. That is where the role of training comes in. So these were all the things that I have sort of said. So why do I need to tell father where I am referring them? Is because this is important as a modular activity, because once you get it wrong from the beginning, so if you refer them without telling them, if you refer them with some other pretext, you are damaging this process, not with that family only. And over there they can sue you about what you have said or what you haven't said, which you should have said. And all these things are important. Without any of this, it will not work. Did you want to say something? Sorry. From here, it's not very visible, so I thought somebody was raising your hand. Did you? No. Okay. Fine. So, what is important is that, understand, when you are disclosing something like that, there is a huge loss of, you know, disempowerment from the patient side. So be prepared for negative angry reaction. Now this is a term from JCI, Joint Commission International, which some of the Apollo hospitals and certainly my hospital is accredited. JCI accredits many of the USA hospitals as well. And during their first visit, this was not there because it was too soon for hospitals of India. They started putting it from the second one, and during the third one, they're increasing the stake. They're gradually making that, are we actually, as a professional group, ready to deal with this? Or are we going to shy away from it? You know? So this is a standard phrase. Why we need to do this? Because it's the child's welfare. That is of paramount. A child may not know. Especially in our country where the family honor might be so high on agenda, the child might have coached into believing in all that. So what do I do? After what I have said, there have been angry reactions. Me and my secretary had to manage it. And after those angry reactions, I had to tell father that whatever reaction you all put up, I'll be documenting all of those. And be aware that it may go against you. Just like, you know, when police is arresting somebody, says that whatever you say may go against you. It is a duty. And there, we need to use our voices. These are all coaching-based methods. You know, you have to, these are experiential learning, workshops. You need to do these things. So I could get the professional support, because these professional things are very important. Diploma in child health, international postgraduate pediatric certificate. This is from Sydney University. These are the things that we have for our medical graduates. Currently that we are running from our hospital and four other centers in India. I think it's six centers now. I'm an examiner in that particular thing for other centers, and I run it from my center. So we do train our doctors in making, postgraduate doctors who may not be exposed to this kind of teaching in Indian postgraduate curriculum. It's all written there. Question is not about what is written and what is not written. How to report? So what I did on that evening is that I actually took out the manual, took it out. It's all laminated. Nobody can take it away. Right? And I followed the procedure. There is a fax number, there is a phone number, there is this, there is that. It's all there. These are the things we'll have to have. We just can't say that we run a clinic and we don't have access to any of those anymore. But when? Today? No. Let us give us some time. Let us put out those resources. This is where all these, you know, people coming together, resource and other things matters. The hapless doctor sitting in a three-tier situation will not have the resources, believe me. And you might have to give them three copies eventually in the course of 3 years to make sure that after that you're then going to catch them. Otherwise it becomes unfair, you see. Anything that is unfair will not work. So you got to put out our hard work also from this CSA group. If we want to make a difference, we have to make certain work that is very hard for us ourselves. Because this is very important question. And this is very important question from our teaching manuals. Postgraduate teaching, which is an international course, developed for outbacks of Australia. Situations very similar to India or various other countries. So that is why this course runs in 14 countries by now, and it is running for last 24 years. It's a very successful thing going on and on. Because this entire system, we are touching one of the rawest, deepest, darkest part of human truth, sexuality. You know, you all know that. It is totally, totally, totally based on trust. And not just goodness of heart of one individual from another. Trust that is reproducible. You have to be able to reproduce it in all your professionals. It can be measured. And it can be. There are a whole host of agencies, and we have talked about it, so there is not much in that, which we'll have to deal with. How do I know all these things? Because by the time I was coming, I was the name doctor for children looked after. You know that Norway case? I'm sure most of you know. So when they searched, they found that I was a person, resource person in that part of the world. That is exactly what our central government, the call that came through to me, would you be able to see doctor? Because, you know, sitting in a private big hospital, it's not easy to do that. And I said, of course I will. Then what happened is a laughable thing, you know, but my name was used in their dossier so that these children can be brought back to India. I never got to assess them. I met them. There are dramas being created out of them. I never got to assess them. And I keep asking myself why I never got to assess them, just because they came back to India. Okay? So we need more skilled health workers. How do we build it? So these are the courses. These are the, you know, she's a professor. These are the students who learn about all these things. This is where we do it. There are other portals also. This is a DCH, MRCPCH, which we can all do now. And this is not just pediatrician we treat. We treat other doctors who deal with children, because 40% of a GP's child workload is pediatrics, but they have no formal training. These are national data we have. We got to train them. So here we have modular breaking news situations, and in pediatric portals, pediatric education, we do. Our recent experience, 23rd of August, we had a mock exam, and 2nd of October, we are doing the real exam in India. I'm actually writing one of the question for the real exam. This is a UK qualification our doctors will have. So in the mock exam, somebody did a modular sort of counseling to a mother whose child is having a brain tumor. All of them failed in that. In the feedback session, there were two scenarios. One was, one feedback was that, doctor, you have said to the mother that I empathize with you, but you will not pass because I didn't see that. You just said it. You mugged it up. You know that these are things that you have to say in UK, USA, Australian exams, and you just said it. I will fail you. You might pass in these exams in your country, but you're not passing and getting an UK qualification out of that. That's number one. Number two is, a very honest practicing pediatrician stood up and said that, you know, what was there to say? I've finished in 1.5 minutes, and you gave us 6 minutes to do it. And the feedback examiner said that in my practice, I'm consultant for so many decades, I find it very difficult to break this news in 6 minutes. And we are assessing what you can manage in these 6 minutes, and you are saying you'd manage it in 1.5 minutes. This is the level of lack of training we have in our country. Competence-based training. And this is what it is. So the doctor was honest enough, opened us the dialogue. And another third thing, which is nothing to do with all this thing, is that there was a session on history taking in childhood asthma. Again, all of them, just four of them passed. All the others failed. It's one of the commonest conditions we meet. And we still don't know what exactly to do. So let us acknowledge the truth. Only then we can make some headway forward. So this brings us to this experiences that we should have. So we have started fellowship in a domain which is very new in India. When I say developmental pediatrics, I have to explain to the pediatrician what it is. So don't be alarmed if you think. We are starting it from this year. We have got our first candidates, because it is very important to do some pioneering things like this in our country. Because he who invented polio vaccine said that if I were a young scientist, I will still do immunization, but instead of immunizing kids physically, I will do it psychologically. And this guy who was sitting in that room as a young boy then took it out and made a psychological vaccine possible, which we deliver from Indian Academy of Pediatrics, TOT, Training of the Trainer. I'm a national trainer on that, on psychological vaccine. So we need to start and catch them young and prevent. We have been talking about prevention, prevention, prevention. So we got to do both things together. And prevention is going to be our biggest tool. And when you prevent something, something like that, you know, the bag, the can of, you know, worms that came out of that can was that there was a pedophile ring with nodal point in that family being involved was going on into this part of the Southeast England, which we broke through that because I acted on that day. And that's the courage, that's the proactive work you have to do. And I'm saying that it's not just me. Any doctor over there who is trained will do that. And this is what we need to bring on to our country. So let's do that. Let's bring it on to our country so that we can sort of quickly do this. Some of the things are data which shows there are, sorry, quickly showing the pass rates. We can do it. So we don't always have to have a tough. So we have a series through which we can do it. And if we do it, we'll have the day not far from us, maybe 3 years, maybe 5 years, where all of our doctors, all of our stakeholders will be trained in that, which is what you have always been teaching. I just bring one particular nuances to it. Thank you.